In this episode, we're having a look at one of the hottest drop tops from England. This is the Aston Martin Vantage Roadster. Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racing driver, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, this Aston Martin Vantage Roadster, certainly fast and it's certainly fun. It's been a couple of years since we've driven the coupe, and they have enhanced this Vantage Roadster a little bit since those days of the Vantage Coupe's introduction. So we have to look at this Vantage Roadster in a little more depth. Mechanically, the Vantage Roadster is very similar to the coupe that we drove a couple of years ago, but it has benefited from some enhancements since then. Under the bonnet is the 4-liter twin-turbo V8 with turbos in the hot V configuration, and we know where this engine comes from. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. It makes 503 horsepower at 6,000 RPM and 505 pounds of torque from 2,000 to 5,000 RPM. That's an impressive torque curve. There is the 8-speed automatic transaxle at the back, and power is transferred to the rear wheels via an alloy torque tube with a carbon fiber drive shaft. In the back, there's an electronically controlled limited slip diff with brake-based torque vectoring as well. The chassis is constructed in Aston Martin's modern style, which is fundamentally made up of a bunch of aluminum extrusions. Suspension is AA arms in the front, multi-link in the rear with adaptive dampers. Brakes, of course, are big multi-piston calipers. Rotors are 400 millimeter two-piece in the front, 360 millimeters in the rear. Steering is electrically assisted, and of course there is variable assist to help you with parking. We do have to talk about the roof for a moment. Not that roofs are particularly interesting, but this one does go up and down in under 7 seconds, and you can actuate it at speeds up to 30 miles an hour, which makes it very useful, as I did the other day when I got caught in some rain. Curb weight of this Aston Martin Vantage Roadster is under 3,600 pounds, but keep in mind it's 160 pounds heavier than the coupe, but I think it works better as a roadster anyway, which we will get into. Weight distribution is 49% front, 51% rear, but on this channel we know that it's not static weight distribution that matters, it's how you use it. It's that time in the episode four, how to spec your Aston Martin Vantage Roadster. Base price in the United States is $147,000. In Canada, I don't have pricing at the moment, but it'll be here on the screen when I do. What you're looking at is yellow tang paint and black metallic leather. Those are your primary colors for this particular Aston Martin Vantage Roadster, and it's a stunning color combination. One thing I don't think, the metallic of that black leather is actually coming through on screen, but trust me, it looks amazing in person. This one is fitted with many thousands of dollars in carbon fiber options inside and out, as well as a $300 umbrella. Other option highlights include the ventilated seats and the wheels that you're looking at. They're optional as well. As tested, this is $203,000 in the US and Canada. Don't have pricing yet. It'll be here on the screen when I do. Now, how do you spec yours? Well, the key consideration is that there are no core fundamental performance options. There's no sticky tire option. There's no carbon ceramic brake option, at least in this part of the world. So you don't have to worry about that. And that's okay, because the car is great as it is. What that leaves you with is choosing your aesthetics. What color do you want for paint? Which colors do you want for hide? And certainly, which wheels do you want? Now, I do have some recommendations. This is bold. I'd go for something a little more subtle, and I'd go for a lighter colored interior, especially given that it is a convertible and it's going to be out in the sun. I don't really care for black interiors and convertibles, but that's another story for another day. Another key recommendation I will pass along is get the suede steering wheel. It just makes the whole driving experience so much better. It enhances it, and it's a lovely thing to steer with. Other than that, pick your colors, enjoy the process when you go to spec your Aston Martin Vantage Roadster. One thing that Aston Martin has done very well for a very long time is seating position. And for me, that means I'm seated nice and low in the chassis. I've got the seat all the way to the floor, and then I've got the steering wheel extended towards me, and that leaves me with a perfect interface to the steering wheel as well as the pedals. Although I will say that I do prefer to wear big skate shoes when I drive these days, and the pedals are placed very close together. With a manual transmission, that might make a little bit more sense, but with a two-pedal car, they're very close together. As well, the way the brake pedal actuates is a little bit different, which we will get into a little bit later. Not really perfectly happy with the two-pedal layout here. I'd like a little bit more space and like them to be on slightly different planes, but we'll get into that in a little bit. A couple of other things I love about this driver interface is the shape of the steering wheel. It's cool, and I love the shape of this, although I'd love to get mine finished in suede or Alcantara, whatever the option is that Aston Martin provides. I think that is a much better steering wheel finish than just simple leather, although this black metallic leather is pretty interesting. And for road cars, I love paddle shifters on the steering column. Race cars are a different deal, but for a road car, you really need paddle shifters on the steering column. We're not racing here. We're trying to enjoy ourselves and be effective as drivers. And for road cars, you really need them on the column. The shape of them is perfect, and they are actually mechanically satisfying to shift with. They're just wonderful. The digital instrument cluster is very legible, very easy to read in any kind of sunlight, and that is wonderful. There's a limited amount of information on the display, so it keeps things very, very simple for you as the driver. The infotainment system, of course, is sourced from Aston Martin's friends at Mercedes-Benz or Daimler, and it does seem a bit dated, and what makes it worse is the fact that there is no Apple CarPlay or Android Auto here. But the rest of the ergonomics are modern Aston Martin, and what that means is you've got these very distinctive shift buttons, but given that this is a convertible, you can't see the little red indicator light on the shift buttons anytime the roof is open and you've got some light outside. It's very charming, but it doesn't work that well in the real world. Given the size and the fact that this is a convertible, there's a remarkable amount of space underneath the boot lid. I think I can fit two carry-ons in there, probably a couple of golf bags. Right now I've got a carry-on size camera bag and my backpack with room to spare. Inside the cabin, storage is a bit limited. Yes, there's a little bit of storage here. There are a couple of almost useless cup holders and some door pockets, and that's as much as you're going to get. But as far as humans being in these seats, you're going to be comfortable along with your passenger. Gotta love that. According to Aston Martin, this Vantage Roadster will do 0 to 60 in 3.6 seconds. I don't doubt it. This is a good thing given that this is just a rear-wheel drive and there seems to be no trouble putting down power. The big wide Pirellis certainly have a lot of stick and the E-Diff has a lot to do with that, but yet it has no problem putting down power in a straight line. And if you've got the courage and keep your foot planted, this will top out at 190 miles an hour. Certainly the most fun is, of course, putting down power, exiting corners. The reason I like E-Diffs and the reason you should too is twofold. One, they're fully variable, which means it can adjust the amount of lock depending on what's going on, depending on G-load, depending on the amount of traction available, how much throttle input you're asking for. It is just a wonderful solution to a limited slip differential. And then when you're braking, what it does is it's fully open, and what that translates to from a driving standpoint is that it is massively stable under braking. So when there's no lock in the diff, this thing is very, very stable under braking. All that does in terms of acceleration as well as braking translates to a lot of confidence behind the wheel for you as the driver. For as aggressively as I've driven this, and we are talking about public roads, and I really don't believe in public road hooning to any extent, but I have never been able to really break traction unless I get hyper aggressive with this Vantage Roadster. And again, I think that speaks to the character of the car, which inspires a lot of confidence to you as the driver. The driving experience itself is dominated by that big, broad, flat torque curve, and what that means is you're never really needing to bring this engine all the way to redline to maximize your acceleration to extract all of that power and that torque. You really don't need to shift at anything beyond 5,000 RPM because making maximum torque above above 2,000 RPM anyway. It's just a remarkable driving experience, and then it makes those beautiful noises. Yes, you're gonna say that the 8-speed automatic is not as snappy as a dual-clutch box, but you know what? This is not a hardcore sports car. This is a bit more of a GT experience, and the transmission does indeed shift quick enough so that it is enjoyable, and I mean, I just love the way this sounds. But what's great about the gearbox is that it rev matches on downshifts, and upshifts are quick when you're asking it for maximum acceleration. But the transmission works very, very well in combination with the engine and that limited slip diff. The dynamic experience is more GT-like than sports car, and there are a number of reasons for that. One is the way that they've set up the suspension. They've allowed the suspension to work, and in a lot of ways, this is kind of like a grown-up, very luxurious MX-5. And Mazda has the same philosophy. They allow the suspension to work, and Aston Martin is doing the same here. And what that means is you've got this wonderful blend of handling and ride quality. It rides very, very comfortably, and beyond the enhanced sounds that this Vantage Roadster now makes, I think what Aston Martin has done is refine the suspension calibrations a little bit further with these adaptive dampers. They seem to be working exceptionally well in each of the distinct drive modes. And speaking of which, I do want to talk about the drive modes for a second. You've got one that controls the drivetrain, and you've got a second button that controls the suspension. I love the fact that they've decoupled the suspension settings from the rest of the drive mode. So what I love doing is getting in this Vantage Roadster, setting drivetrain to either Sport Plus or Track, and just works wonderfully. Of course, that makes the exhaust a little bit louder, but makes the rest of the drivetrain a little bit sharper. And given that we're driving on public roads, I don't touch the damper button. So I let the dampers do their work as they're supposed to do. We are driving on public roads. They're not billiard table smooth. They're not like a racetrack. There's no need to go any firmer than the standard setting. It just works wonderfully as a combination. I also have to say that body and wheel control is excellent. I don't want to overlook that. The way that they've put together this suspension is just wonderful. It works so well. And then yet it's a very comfortable ride as well. Steering is sharp and precise. Maybe it could be a little bit quicker, but this is a GT. This is a Grand Tourer rather than a hardcore sports car. This is not like a 911 GT3, so it doesn't need to be super quick. And yes, I do love that sort of thing, but I think it would detract from the overall driving experience if you had a quicker steering rack in this thing. Turn in response, just fantastic, and it's immediate. Certainly the Pirellis have a lot to do with that. But otherwise, I'd like a little bit more feedback. This is an electric-based system, doesn't have a lot of feel or feedback, but on the other hand, chassis feel is absolutely spot on. And overall feel is almost telepathic, and again, I think that has to do with the way they've let the suspension work. I can really feel what's going on at each corner because each corner is doing the work that it's supposed to do. Aston Martin's done a great job with the suspension, and as a driver, I feel really connected with this car. Love the way this thing can carve a line. There's not a lot of body roll. There's just enough to let you know what it's doing, but there's not a tremendous amount of body roll either. Corners relatively flat. And then hauling through this corner just carves a line perfectly. One thing I do want to talk about is brake actuation. And for years, I loved the brake actuation of Aston Martin's carbon ceramics. These steel brakes, yes, they're powerful and easy to modulate, but it's that initial pedal input that has me a little bit bothered. I don't know if it's because this car has a lot of miles on it. Yes, it does have a lot of miles, but it drives like it's brand new. But it may be suffering from maybe some overuse of those front brakes, and maybe the brake fluid needs to be changed given that it is a press car after all. Nonetheless, there is a little bit more play in that pedal. There's a little bit more travel in that pedal than I would like before the brake pads start to bite. And what ends up happening, given that the brake and throttle pedals are close together, sometimes my big skate shoe will hit that throttle pedal and have to adjust my foot. What I don't care for is that extra bit of travel at the top of the brake pedal. Once you get into it, however, modulation is very precise. And of course, given the size of these brakes, there's lots of braking power. And yeah, when you're into the pedal, you can control the attitude of the car. It's just when you're driving around town, it's a little softer in terms of that initial application than I would like. Overall, the driving experience in this Vantage Roadster is exactly what I expected, and it is just a lovely all-around grand touring roadster. I just love piloting this thing, and on this road, it is just magic. This is the perfect environment for this Vantage Roadster. This is the kind of roadster that turns any drive into a special occasion. And then when you get to your destination, everybody's going to be looking at this thing because there's nothing like an Aston Martin. My verdict, well, we often start this segment with fuel consumption, so I might as well hit it. I'm doing about 15 miles per gallon, but regular viewers know that my mileage is based on the fact that I prefer to drive for pleasure, not for fuel consumption. Your mileage will be better, and rest assured, I have been enjoying the throttle on this Vantage Roadster. Now, what do I think about the Vantage Roadster? Well, I think this is the best way to enjoy the Vantage. Aesthetically, I think it looks much better, and I love what they've done with this deck lid shaping. It is just beautiful now. Even with a top up, it's easy to live with. The top goes up and down in just a few seconds, and it's quiet inside when you've got the top up. But if you enjoy open cars like I do, this is just a wonderful thing. And then, of course, with the top down, you hear all the wonderful noises that come from this exhaust. It is just a wonderful experience. I do have to bring up one point. While I've been driving this Vantage Roadster, the question of the value proposition has come up. And if you're looking at value, well, you're missing the point of an Aston Martin. You're missing that hand-finished interior. You're missing the exclusivity of an Aston Martin. If you are looking to spend at a price point, you're missing completely the point of an Aston Martin. Aston Martin is about exclusivity. It's about that British attitude. It's about the aesthetic. And man, does it sound good with the top down. I love driving this thing, and it is a very special, very unique piece. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2021 Aston Martin Vantage Roadster. Hope you liked this episode, and if you did, well, you're not new to YouTube. You know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring. So please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because as I understand, people on Reddit need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you want to support the channel, well, hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our popular line of Save the Manuals merch, and I think Aston Martin still makes a manual transmission. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time, and remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even Aston Martins.